Okay, but also creatinine clearance. Basically, when we were doing the structure of nephron in some subject, we have seen like it has glomerulus, proximal convoluted tubule, Henle's loop, distal convoluted tubule. The concept is when the blood is getting filtered, I think structure, yeah. See, this is our nephron, right? So we have this bluish network is the like capillary network, glomerulus. Here we have Bowman's capsule, PCT, Henle's loop, DCT and collecting duct. So whenever a blood is coming under high pressure in the glomerulus, it gets filtered and it is entering into the PCT. Now, not only like once the blood is filtered, water, minerals, urea, uric acid, creatinine, so many nitrogenous metabolites will come. They get filtered and they enter as glomerular filtrate. Don't use the word urine. That is still glomerular filtrate. Now the why we are depending more on creatinine is, creatinine, how is it produced? Whenever we are doing any muscle contraction, during muscle contraction, creatine is converted to creatinine. Okay? The metabolic end product of creatine is creatinine. So once creatinine is entering into the blood circulation, it is getting filtered. And the significance of creatinine is it is nowhere reabsorbed in the renal tubule. Remember this fact. At the same time, that means it is not reabsorbed by the tubular cells. And it is not even secreted by the tubular cells. That means it is neither reabsorbed nor secreted into the lumen of nephron. That's the reason how much ever is filtered. Suppose if it is, I don't remember the correct value. If it is 1 milligram, suppose if it is filtered in the glomerulus, the one milligram of creatinine passes out through this nephron and it is seen in the urine. Okay. Nowhere it is reabsorbed, nowhere it is secreted and added into the lumen of nephron. That is the importance. That's why creatinine is very much standard to determine whether kidney is functioning normal or not. By checking the normal range of creatinine, we can say, yes, creatinine values are normal. That means kidney is functioning normally. Okay. So that's how you take creatinine clearance test. So clearance test, basically the glomerular filtration rate you are measuring. So most useful in assessing the kidney function. The excretion of that creatinine can be expressed. Clearance in general, he's talking. I'm just using the word creatinine in the presence of substance. Wherever you are finding substance, you can substitute. We have not only creatinine clearance test, we have urea clearance test, uric acid clearance test, inulin clearance test. Okay, inulin is a dye, artificial dye, which you can inject through the vein. This dye gets excreted through the urine. Okay, but it's not safe to use a foreign dye, a foreign color like inulin, because it may have some autoimmune reactions also, some rejection reactions. It's not used much. Best thing is always to go with creatinine. Okay, so always this formula will remain same beta. Any clearance you go with. Okay, for example, here you have creatinine clearance. I said we also have urea clearance. Okay, we also, of course, the other clearance tests are not given here, but we have in physiology. Okay. Any clearance test, you have to elaborate or work out on this formula only. C is equal to U into V by P. C is nothing but clearance. That means how much amount of creatinine is getting filtered in the glomerulus. That is the meaning of clearance. Okay, how much amount, that is expressed as milliliter per minute. Okay, then U is nothing but concentration of creatinine for now. Creatinine in urine, V is volume of urine in ml excreted per minute, and P is the concentration of that particular substance in plasma. Okay, so that is. So you just substitute. See, the other things which we can use other than creatinine and urea, we can also go with diodrast. This is one dye, para amino hippuric acid and all. Okay, so you substitute the values in this formula. And see here, we have this reference range. Like what is the normal range of creatinine clearance? It is 120 to 145 ml per minute. Okay. These values are slightly lower in women. Why? I told you creatinine is the byproduct of muscle activity. More muscular work. whoever does, usually they will have little more creatinine in the urine. So usually in men only it will be high. So in recent year, creatinine clearance is expressed in terms of body surface area also. That means if this reference value, you have to check and then just compare. If it has increased, then you can go, like, give an assessment like there is something wrong with kidney function, impairment of kidney function. Okay, beta? That's what is creatinine clearance test. Then after that, what is the next question? Ritika? Shorts, I gave you the response.
Genetic
code, page number, beta?
551.
Okay, all of you please come to 551 page. Genetic code is a code word, right? 551. Yeah, beta, we are here. Okay. See, genetic code. See, basically, when we have studied our second answer, we have come across the nitrogen bases, isn't it? The nitrogen bases, you have named them as what are the names? Adenine, guanine, thymine, cytosine, uracil, anything can come. Okay, so there is like the sequence of nitrogen bases, what we have. Basically, when you see the structure of genetic code, the three nucleotides together, that is the triplet, UUU, CUU, AGA, GGG, something like that. Okay, so the set of three nucleotides, that too, you should take it continuously only. The set of three nucleotides which are coding for one amino acid. Basically, how many amino acids do we have, beta? We have 20 amino acids. Okay? So for 20 amino acids, basically, we have 20 different codes. In fact, not 20. We have around 61 codons. That means we have 61 different genetic codes which are coding for 20 amino acids. That means we will come across a hypothesis which is called as Wobble hypothesis. That means where a set of three or four genetic codes are also coding for only one amino acid. That's the reason you have more code words, but we have only 20 amino acids. So there are certain general rules to talk when you talk about this genetic code. Okay, it's everybody knows like it is made up of three nucleotides. The genetic code can be like... it's a dictionary of nucleotide bases, A, G, C, U, anything can come, beta. Okay? The codons are composed of four nucleotide bases, adenine, guanine, cytosine, and uracil. Okay? Because it is RNA, no? Messenger RNA, ribosomal RNA, and transfer RNA. These are the RNAs which are involved in the protein synthesis. And genetic code is bringing the amino acid so that it can be piled up for the formation of proteins. That's the reason you are not finding thymine here. Instead, you are finding uracil. Okay, because now we are talking about RNA, okay, which is helping in the synthesis of like proteins better. Okay, then that is one thing. See, suppose if these code words, if they go on synthesize, like if they go on bringing amino acid, amino acid, amino acid, then there may be a unlimited size of the amino acid chain. So that is not feasible for our body to like accommodate such big chain of polypeptide chains, isn't it? So in order to avoid that, we also have certain stop signals, which are called as stop codons, which are not coding for any amino acid. You call, like, what are these we have? We have UAA, UAG, and UGA. They do not code for any amino acids. Hence, they are called as stop signals. Okay? That means the amino acid chain length will stop once these genetic codons or code words are coming into picture. Okay, beta? So that is, these codons, UAA, AG and UGA, the special names are given. Like UAG is also called as amber, ochre, and opal, respectively. Okay, beta? These are some other names. basically sometimes AUG and GUG, they are sometimes, not always, they are called as initiating codons. That means the protein chain is now starting or beginning. The amino acid is not always the same amino acid will be there for all proteins. No, this statement is not always correct. Okay, now let us see the norm general characteristics of a genetic code. First of all, it is universal. That means whether you take in plants or animals or bacteria or any living organism in the earth, always this genetic code will code for same amino acid. Okay. Like for example, UAG, it may be coding for something like glutamic acid. Okay, I'm telling only examples which are actually not correct. I'm just giving few examples to make you understand. Okay, AUG may code for glycine. Some CAG may code for alanine, valine, something like that. But with any of the living organisms on the earth, it will code for same amino acids. Okay, that is called as universality. Okay. So, but of course, there may be few exceptions. Like, for example, AUA is a codon for methionine in mitochondria. The same codon AUA is coding for isoleucine in cytoplasm. Okay, that is few exceptions, but most of the times it is universal. Then we have specificity. A particular codon always codes for same amino acid, hence the genetic code is highly specific. Okay, then non-overlapping. That means, see, you have used here certain like slash here, but in fact usually we do not have any slash in the continuity. When you write for a genetic code, you have to write it continuously. That's what is called as non-overlapping. Okay, we have actually discussed about frame shift mutations when we were doing mutations. Frame shift in the sense, suppose this is a genetic code which is coding for one sequence of amino acid, because of sudden exposure to UV rays or some background, you are finding a part of it is cut and it is pasted across the last part of the genetic code, like this whole length. So because of which the amino acids which are coming and which are attaching in this amino acid chain also will change. Okay, that means it will code for some different protein instead of the protein which is required. Okay, that is non-overlapping. Then degenerate. That means what I already told you, basically we have only 20 amino acids, but we have 61 code words. That means 3 to 4 code words are coding for same amino acids. That is what is called as a degenerate. Once you, in order to understand this better, we need to do this Wobble hypothesis. Okay, so in this Wobble hypothesis, you see here, basically in this Wobble hypothesis, the single tRNA can recognize more than one codon. Okay, for example, see here, UUU, UUC, UUA, and UUG. All these are 4 different genetic codes. Okay, like for example, here we have 5 different genetic codes. They are coding for serine. Okay, UUU and UUC are coding for phenylalanine. UUA, UUG is for leucine, something like that. But if you closely observe, first two code words are same, but most of the times the last code word is only different. That means the last code word is generally overread by tRNA, because of which you will see only first two are being concentrated. The last two, it can be anything, because of which that is the explanation given by Wobble hypothesis. The last genetic code word is basically differing, because of which the first two code words are only taken as standard, and that is leading to the transfer of that particular amino acid to the chain of protein synthesis during translation. Okay, beta? So like that you have, if you observe, first two code words are always similar. The last one is differing. That's how, see, 4 of them are coding for valine only. Like that you have many examples. Okay, the elaborate, if you understand this table, you need not memorize this table. You can give few examples. Okay, because memorizing this table, nobody will like expect so much. It's not required. Humanly, it is difficult to remember also all petty things also. So you just try to understand the concept of what Wobble hypothesis is. Okay, and read once, you will understand. Hope you understood better. Imad, Ritika?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, beta, thank you. Then give me the next question. Page number. Facilitated.
651, ma'am. 651. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. facilitated diffusion. Facilitated in the sense there are certain changes which take place in the cell membrane so as to allow the things to come inside. Okay, beta. Now see here, and the question is facilitated diffusion, transport across cell membrane. Suppose, see, all the living organisms are made up of cells. Suppose if something has to come outside, it has to cross the cell membrane to enter into the cytoplasm. Glucose comes, sodium comes, chloride comes, potassium. As per the requirement, so many minerals, water comes, and so many things come inside the cytoplasm, isn't it? So for which we have different mechanisms of transport. We have active transport, we have passive transport. Active transport is the one where you will see ATP will be involved in the transport mechanism. Passive is just because of the difference in concentration gradient, you will see there will be diffusion. Okay, then next, just a minute. So now passive diffusion, in this passive diffusion, that means just there is some concentration gradient difference. Outside concentration is high and inside concentration is low, because of which the things which are outside are moving across the cell membrane and coming inside. That is the meaning of diffusion. Okay. So facilitated diffusion in the sense the cell membrane is facilitating itself. The shape is changing in such a way that it is allowing, suppose this is glucose molecules, beta, which are waiting outside, and this is the cell membrane, and it is like closed in the form of pong. Now immediately, in order to allow the glucose molecules to enter inside the cytoplasm, this L gets inverted and allows the glucose molecules to enter inside. So this is ping pong theory. This is one of the theory which is helping us to understand the mechanism of facilitated diffusion. That means cell membrane is modifying itself in such a way that outside things are coming inside, beta. Okay, that is. What is the next question, Ritika, and page number, please?
Ma'am, I don't know the page number for that.
Okay, fine, no problem. I'll tell you. What is regulation of? Oh, okay, beta. This is actually where mineral metabolism. You please take out, beta. Mineral metabolism. Meanwhile, I will also try checking that chapter. Mineral metabolism, calcium. Mineral calcium, you take out. Did you get the page number, Imad? Mineral metabolism?
I'm searching.
Ah, it's okay. Fine. Take your time.
Ma'am, 6 question, right?
Yes, beta. Okay. Calcium. Metabolism of lipids after this only, I guess. Mineral metabolism.
Ma'am, it will come under vitamin D.
No, beta. Not vitamin. There is a separate chapter, mineral metabolism. Okay.
Yeah, mineral metabolism.
Ha, mineral metabolism. Okay.
On page 404.
Yeah, 403 is the chapter. 403, mineral metabolism. Let's go to there. Okay.
403.
Yeah. Take out calcium there. Tell me the page number.
404 ma'am.
Okay, beta, thank you. Yeah, so now actually this question is also important in physiology. This question comes in both physiology and biochemistry. Okay, the question is, see, regulation of serum calcium levels. Okay, so there is a flowchart for this. Basically, calcium, where do we find calcium, beta? We find calcium in the bones, in the muscles, isn't it? In the teeth. So very, very important mineral. To summarize fast, like it is helping in muscle contraction. Fourth clotting factor is calcium, blood coagulation. We have seen synapse and neurotransmission. There calcium was involved, no? Membrane integrity, membrane permeability. So many functions is it does. Now, there is serum calcium levels and how it is regulated. This also comes in physiology. The normal plasma calcium levels are 9 to 11 milligrams per deciliter. It has to be maintained constant like this. It should neither reduce nor increase. Okay? If it is reducing, you call it as hypocalcemia. If it is increasing, it is leading to hypercalcemia. What is the hormone which is increasing blood calcium level?
Parathyroid hormone.
Very good. What is the hormone which is reducing blood calcium level?
Thyrocalcitonin.
Very good. Thyrocalcitonin. Okay, nice. Very good, beta. Now let us see the source of calcium first. The source of calcium, like milk is a very good source, non-vegetarian diet, so many are there, beta. So like whatever source we take, when we take calcium in the diet, it is entering into the intestines. Okay. And the calcium is absorbed there in the intestines and transported into the blood. Okay. So the absorption of calcium is also facilitated by the active form of vitamin D, that is calcitriol. Okay, PTH is acting here for the active absorption of calcium from the intestines and getting transported to the blood. So why this plasma calcium has to be maintained so much constant? Because so many metabolic activities are regulated, no? Muscle contraction, blood coagulation, neurotransmission, membrane integrity, so many functions are there. That's why this level has to be maintained. Okay, so suppose if this level is falling below 9 milligrams, then immediately the PTH will come into action. It will dissolve the bone resorption, and it will like mobilize the bone calcium to the blood. Okay, so PTH, parathyroid hormone, through hook or crook, either through increased reabsorption of calcium through the intestines or through the dissolution of calcium from bones, whatever way. See, like this PTH, like sees that the blood calcium levels are coming back to normal. What happens in case if already, if it is 12 to 13 grams, if the blood calcium is rising, then what happens immediately? Calcitonin, which is coming from parafollicular cells of the thyroid gland, it comes into picture and it starts lowering the blood calcium. That means now the calcium gets deposited in the bones, wherever it is required. In the, like, calcium also gets deposited wherever we have dead cells, in necrosis area, in all those many areas we have. Okay, that is, so that's how you will see, this is the regulation. So if you just read it in detail, you will understand better. So the blood calcium levels have to be maintained always constant, and the hormones which are helping are parathyroid hormone, calcitriol. They actually help in increase in blood calcium levels, and calcitonin helps in reduction of blood calcium levels. Okay, so you just read once, you will definitely understand. Whatever I told you is elaborated. Sources also milk products, beans, leafy vegetables, fish, cabbage, egg yolk. Okay, fine. What's the next question? Page number, if you have with you, Kritika.
482, ma'am.
Respiratory acidosis. 482, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, good. This also we have discussed so much, in fact, when we were doing These days we have stopped physiology, biochemistry for a long time. Otherwise, we used to do every alternate days that this, right? That's the reason I'm thinking I should focus it more.
Yes.
Okay, but a 482 page respiratory acidosis. Can you recollect what happens here?
Ma'am, in respiratory acidosis, the PCO2 will increase. The H plus ions concentration also increases in blood.
Yeah, very good, very good. Can you tell me what are the reasons, causes for respiratory acidosis?
Decreased rate of ventilation.
Okay, nice. That means all respiratory disorders.
Respiratory disorders.
Like COVID. COVID is the best example you can give. Is directly acting on respiratory system. Okay.
Yes.
Obstructive respiratory disorders. Okay. Now see, this is the question we have. Here it is something like respiratory acidosis. Imad has given a very good answer. I appreciate. Very good. See here. Basically, in case of respiratory acidosis, what is happening? The carbon dioxide levels are increasing, rising in the blood. So we know carbon dioxide combines with CO2 combines with H2O to form H2CO3. That is the universal formula. Carbonic anhydrase is the enzyme which is involved. So that means carbonic acid is increased in the blood because of underlying respiratory disorders. That's what is called as respiratory acidosis. So it can be severe asthma, it can be pneumonia, cardiac arrest, obstruction in airways, chest deformities, depression of respiratory center. Respiratory center we find in medulla oblongata, no? Dorsal group of neurons, ventral group of neurons, apneustic center, no? All those. So all these are actually responsible for respiratory acidosis, beta. Okay? Now let's move to very shorts. So we have less time, 9 minutes only. Papers will usually take more time, beta. Okay, non-protein amino acids. What's the page number, Imad?
54.
Just name them, no, beta. Open it and just name them. Non-protein amino. Please, beta.
Okay. Non-protein amino acids are ornithine, citrulline, arginosuccinic acid.
Okay.
And thyroxine, triiodothyronine.
Very good. Why are they called as non-protein? That means though they are amino acids, but still they are not going and taking part in the formation of polypeptide chain for the formation of our normal proteins. Okay, beta? Got it?
Yes, ma'am.
Nice. Very good. Next, we have biochemical functions of selenium. Just now we have seen calcium, no? Same chapter, we will have some functions of selenium also.
Yes, ma'am. Page number 132.
Read few.
The element selenium is found in enzyme glutathione peroxidase that destroys free radicals.
Okay. Any more function it has given, beta?
It is synergistic with vitamin E.
Okay, fine. 2-3 more functions you please read, beta, if it is available.
That is only given.
Okay. That's enough also. Don't worry. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Then name two biologically important nucleotides and mention their functions.
That is on page number 73.
Okay.
Purine and pyrimidine nucleotides.
Yes.
And also CAMP, CGMP.
Okay.
GTP, GDP.
Okay. So
UDP, glucose, CDP, acylglycerol.
All these will come during our reactions, no beta, when you practice cycles. So he is asking any two functions. So while you practice these, wherever these things, UDP, whatever comes, no, you just put it here as examples, beta. Okay?
Okay.
Menkes disease, page number. And please
page number 420.
Okay.
It's in copper.
Copper deficiency.
It is due to defect in intestinal absorption of copper.
Copper overabsorption is Wilson's disease and copper deficiency is Menkes. Okay, very Menkes. Good. Okay.
Causes anemia, depigmentation.
Okay, nice. Very good, beta. Can you just elaborate this PAPS phosphoadenosine, phosphosulfate, PEPs.
It is related to cysteine.
Okay, fine.
It is involved, utilized for the synthesis of polysaccharides, okay, and also nice. Detoxification.
Okay, nice. It is helping in detoxification. It helps in the formation of polysaccharides. It is found
mucopolysaccharides.
Mucopolysaccharides. Very good. That's enough, Peta. So we are done with this paper. Okay. So we will stop here. If possible, I'll take in the college, or not, I'll take in the evening after 7 p.m. anytime. Please make yourself available during these timings. Okay, Peta? Okay, then.
Okay.
Okay, Peta.
Okay,
thank you. Good night, Peta. Most welcome, guys.